I'm speaking now about two of my books, Seven Experiments That Could Change the World and Ways to Go Beyond and Why They Work. I've never spoken about these two books bracketed together before, but Hardo's asked me to do this. And I've had to think about what they have in common. I hadn't thought about this before, but what they have in common is actually, to me at least, quite interesting. Seven Experiments That Could Change the World is about seven different ways in which we can break out of the rather dogmatic materialism in which science has been stuck for many decades. And there are also ways in which we can break out of the idea that our minds are confined to the insides of our heads. The standard materialist view, as I'm sure you all know by now, is that the mind is nothing but the activity of the brain and is confined to the inside of the head. And I think this is not true for humans, and I think it's not true for animals either. And in my book, Seven Experiments That Could Change the World, the first three chapters deal with unexplained abilities of animals. One of them is about the way that termites and other social insects are able to coordinate their activity so that termites, for example, can build a structure, a mound, 2 meters high, with millions of insects within it. Each insect is blind, and each one, when they're building the mound, can carry only a small ball of mud. And yet, these individual insects with tiny brains, without being able to see what they're doing, are able to put these little balls of mud all in the right places so that an enormously complex piece of architecture emerges. How do they coordinate it? How does that work? And one of my experiments, the first one, is concerned with this problem. And it's based on the fact that the South African biologist, Eugene Marais, did an experiment with termites where he put a metal plate, he broke a mound open, put a metal plate in it, dividing it into two parts. And then the termites repaired the mound, making arches and tunnels and things that lined up on both sides of the metal plate running into the mound, showing that it wasn't about smell or tapping each other or physical contact. It was as if there was an invisible blueprint, which I would call the field of the termite mound, that was directing the activity of the insects. And I propose experiments with termites or other social insects in that chapter, because I think they could show how societies as a whole, human societies as well, are coordinated by social fields, fields that link together, invisibly link together, the various members of the group. Fortunately, most people would think, in Europe, we don't have termite mounds, at least not in Northern Europe. So you can't actually do the experiment here with termites, but you can do something similar with ants. Somebody once said to me that I was the only person in Britain who thought it was unfortunate that we didn't have termites in Britain. In places where they occur, of course, they're immensely destructive. I also talk in one of these chapters about dogs that know when their owners are coming home. Many dogs and cats, horses, parrots, and other animals know when their owners are returning. They go and wait by a door or window, sometimes 10 minutes, sometimes half an hour, before the person comes home. And most people assume it's just routine, or it's subtle cues, or it's hearing familiar car sounds as the person comes home. But I've done lots of research on this, filming the place the dog waits, having people come home at randomly selected times they don't know in advance, coming in unfamiliar vehicles, so there's no familiar sounds or smells. People at home don't know when they're coming. It's not a routine time. And yet, these dogs still know, and we have all that on film. And I think it's because they're picking up telepathically the intentions of their owners. I think telepathy is much more common among dogs and cats than it is among most people, at least most so-called civilized modern people. I think telepathy is normal, not paranormal, natural, not supernatural. And it's an animal power that connects together members of social groups. It's how they communicate at a distance. I think it's perfectly normal means of communication in animal groups. And it happens with humans too, but most of us aren't as good at it as our dogs and our cats. I've written a whole book on that research, which came out after Seven Experiments, called Dogs That Know When Their Owners Are Coming Home and Other Unexplained Powers of Animals. A third experiment with animals concerns homing pigeons. How do pigeons find their way home? Here in Britain, it's a popular sport. I don't know if it is in Estonia, but in Britain, pigeon racing is quite a popular sport. It has several hundred thousand people who do it. And they race their pigeons from distances of 800 kilometers or more from their home. The pigeons can be taken hundreds of kilometers from their home in any direction. And when they're released, they circle around in the sky and then they fly in their homeward direction. And they usually get home in the same day, flying at an average speed of 60 miles an hour. I've forgotten what that is in kilometers per hour. They fly almost directly home. How do they do it? How does this homing instinct work? It's closely related to the sense of direction as shown by migratory birds and other migratory animals. And I'm going to come back to that in a few minutes and say a little more about homing pigeons. The second part of Seven Experiments is to do with unexplained human powers and abilities. One of the experiments I propose is to do with the feeling of being stared at. Many people, in fact, most people, about 95% of the population, have had the experience of feeling someone's looking at them, and then they turn around and someone is looking at them, or staring at someone from behind, and that person then turns around and looks straight at them. This is a very common experience. It happens with animals as well. Animals can tell when people are looking at them, and people can tell when animals are looking at them. And I've done a lot of experiments on this. I propose an experiment in that book, but since then I've done experiments with hundreds of thousands of trials with school children in Britain, in Germany, and in the United States. It's been done widely in universities and colleges. And there's now overwhelming evidence that this phenomenon really exists. And it really exists even when people are being watched through closed circuit television surveillance systems, perhaps surprisingly. Anyway, this work has all been written up in a special book called called The Sense of Being Stared At and Other Aspects of the Extended Mind. So those are experiments that show human minds are more extensive. That experiment shows our minds more extensive than our brains. They stretch out into the world around us. If I look at you, you can somehow pick up my intention at a distance. And not only do you know that someone's looking at you, but you sense the direction. Usually people turn around and look straight at the person who's looking. They don't just vaguely look around trying to see who's looking for them. It's usually a directional phenomenon. And that shows our minds stretch out beyond our brains in visual perception. Our attention and our intention stretch out into the world around us. I think our minds also stretch out into our bodies. And that's why I have a chapter, an experiment on phantom limbs. People who've had their arm or their leg amputated usually have a phantom limb. It feels as if the limb is still there. And the usual assumption in conventional medical science and biology is to say that there is a kind of phantom limb somewhere inside the brain. They produce a phantom of the missing limb, and it's all inside the head. It's not where it seems to be, where the arm is. If this was a phantom arm, I could move it around, it would feel real. Well, I think that the phantom arms and legs are the fields of the missing limbs. They're what I call morphic fields. And I think there's something really there, the field of the missing limb, which is what the person is feeling. So the question is, can you detect these fields? And I suggest an experiment, which has already been done successfully, where you push the phantom arm through a barrier, like a door, and in a randomized place, there's six places you could push it through. One of them is randomly selected. You push your phantom arm through the door. Say this is the door. Say this is my phantom arm. My phantom arm can go through a door. Being a phantom, it can go through a solid object. So on this side of the door, there's a phantom arm sticking through. And what we do is we ask people who work with subtle energy medicine or Reiki or other forms of healing or dowsing, if they can see where the phantom arm is. So they have six places there could be a phantom arm. Here's one where there is a phantom arm. Can they detect the phantom arm? And with results significantly above chance, they can. There hasn't been that much research on phantom arms, and this is a wide open field of inquiry. If any of you are listening and know someone with a phantom limb or do subtle energy medicine and feel you could do this kind of research, do please let me know. You can email me through my website, sheldrake.org, because I'm keen to do more experiments with phantom limbs. It has huge implications for understanding the relation of the mind and the body. And the experiments cost nothing. That's one of the points of the Seven Experiments That Could Change the World book. The subtitle is A Do-It-Yourself Guide to Revolutionary Science, because it's very hard to get funding for revolutionary science. So I tried to find experiments that could be done on budgets of $10 or less, so you don't actually need funding. You don't have to get tangled in frustration with government or foundations who won't give you a grant for the unconventional research. You can just do it. And this phantom limb experiment is one that you can just do. You can just do the staring experiment or the one with dogs as well. It's a little more complicated to do the pigeon or the termite experiments. And then the final section of my Seven Experiments book is really about science. How is it that experiments could actually help science become liberated from its excessively dogmatic standpoint? And there are two experiments. One of them involves looking at the fundamental physical constants, the speed of light, the charge on the electron, the universal gravitational constant. There are seven or more, usually seven fundamental physical constants, which are supposed to be fixed for all time by conventional science. They're supposed to have been there since the Big Bang, and they never change. So, and that's why they're called constants. But if you actually look up the measured values of the constants, they vary. And some of them vary quite a lot. The gravitational constant has errors of up to 1% or even more in some recent measurements. When I say errors, I mean that different measurements by different groups are quite different from each other, even though they claim that there's only a tiny error in their measurements. This one claims only a tiny error, and yet they're that big, the difference is that big between them, much bigger than the supposed error. So this raises the question that do fundamental constants vary? Could they actually vary? Do they change as the Earth goes around the sun, as the solar system moves through the galaxy? We may move through astronomical environments, for example. They may contain dark matter, which physicists like to say is present throughout the galaxy. If you go through some dark matter, it might affect the measurements of the gravitational constant. There might be good reasons why they're varying, which science has ignored. Right now, what they do is pretend that they're constant. They take the latest value and say, well, that's the latest value of the physical constant. All scientists should use this new value. And they forget about all the previous ones. And it's assumed that all these variations are mere errors of some kind. But what if they're actually fluctuating? What if physical constants are actually changing? The quality of time in the universe might change. It might be a little bit like stock market valuations in the daily newspapers, or the euro-dollar exchange rate. They fluctuate, and maybe the constants are fluctuating like that, and And it may be that to know what's going on at any particular time, you need to know the present value of them, not assuming some average value is the true value for all of universal history. Anyway, that's one experiment. And there's increasing evidence since that book first came out that the constants do fluctuate, even on a 24-hour basis, and certainly on an annual basis, and most pronounced with gravitation. And the other experiment is about experimenter effects. It's been known since the 1960s that experimenters influence the results of their experiments. If they are, for example, in a classic study by someone called Robert Rosenthal, who was a professor at Harvard, students were told that they were being given either very bright rats that had been bred for intelligence or stupid rats that had been bred for stupidity. And they were asked to test the bright and the stupid rats on a maze and see how long they took to learn it. Well, not surprisingly, most of the students found that the intelligent rats learned it quicker than the stupid rats, which is obviously what you'd expect. But what they didn't know was that the actual rats labeled intelligent and stupid were randomly selected from the same population. There was no difference in intelligence at all. Yet they'd found the intelligent rats were more intelligent than the stupid rats. And this is called an experimenter effect. It's now well known in most branches of science that experimenters often get the results they want. They certainly don't always get the results they want, but the experimenters somehow bias the results. And this could be through selective recording of data, discarding data that don't fit what you expect, and perhaps even mind over matter effects on scientific apparatus or on the experimental animals or organisms. This is a completely unexplored area, except that in recent years, it's become clear that the great majority of scientific papers in biomedical science, up to 90%, can't be replicated. Even prestigious papers in prestigious journals turn out not to be replicable. And this was a huge shock to most scientists because they assumed that science was, unlike any other human activity, uniquely reliable, trustworthy, and could be replicated. And actually, they can't. And I think part of the reason is for experimenter effects, because of the experimenter effects. In my chapter on experimenter effects, I suggest an experiment that could be done to test for them and to see how big they are. A very simple experiment, it could be done in any school laboratory or any undergraduate laboratory class. And again, if any of you teach in schools or universities and feel you could do this simple experiment, though, then let me know. The simple experiment is very simple. Half the class do the regular scientific practical where they know what result to expect, and the other half do it blind where they don't know. And the question is there any difference in the results when it's done blind compared with when it's done under open conditions? And surprisingly, even though experimenter effects are now well known, even though there's been a replication crisis in science in the last few years, the vast majority of scientific research in biology, physics, and chemistry is done without blind methodology. It's really only within psychology, parapsychology, and medicine that blind methods are routinely used. So anyway, those are the seven experiments, and they were ones that would, and some already have, begun to lead us into much wider fields of inquiry. It's like breaking out of a prison, a dogmatic prison within which science has been confined. And there's so much more to explore than is allowed within that the prisons of scientific thinking. Now, the one that I want to talk about in a little more detail is homing pigeons, because this will help lead on to my talk about ways to go beyond the second book I'm discussing. Homing pigeons can find their home from hundreds of kilometers away. How do they do it? Well, ever since Charles Darwin, people have been trying to work out how they do it. Darwin thought they did it by remembering the way out, keeping track of the twists and turns of the outward journey. But it's been shown that if you anaesthetize pigeons and take them out in a rotating container in a very devious route in a darkened van, even though they couldn't possibly remember the twists and turns of the outward journey, they can fly straight home. Then people thought it was landmarks. Well, they can use landmarks when they're familiar with them, and that's usually near the home, but you can take them hundreds of kilometers away where they can't see any familiar landmarks, and they still fly straight home, as they do in these pigeon races. Then people thought it was smell, and it was shown it can't be smell because you can sever their olfactory nerves or anaesthetize their nasal membrane, and they can still find their way home. Then people thought it was the sun's position, working out the time, the latitude and longitude from the position of the sun, as if they were enormously sophisticated computers. To do that, you'd need to know the exact time. And it turns out that pigeons can home on cloudy days. They can even be trained to home at night when they can't see the sun, and even if you time shift them. And the only theory left really is magnetism. And if you talk to people today, the chances are they'll say, oh, they do it by magnetism. There's been some recent research showing that birds' eyes contain photoreceptor pigments that may be sensitive to the magnetic field and could possibly enable them to see the magnetic field so they'd know where north and south are. But that's not enough. If you were parachuted into an unknown place and given a compass, a very sensitive compass, then you wouldn't know where home was. You'd know where north and south were, but you wouldn't be able to find your way home. And yet pigeons can do it from any point of the compass, and they find their way home. So it can't just be magnetism. It may help them if they have a magnetic sense, but it's not the basis of their homing. The experiment I propose in that book is the opposite of the normal experiments. Normally people take the pigeons from their home and then try and work out how they find the home, come back to the home. In my experiments, it's the opposite. You take the home from the pigeons. You have a mobile pigeon loft. And I've actually done this experiment in Ireland, in England, and also in Holland, in the Netherlands, with mobile pigeon lofts. And the pigeons can find their mobile home over distances of 10, 15 kilometers. That's not very impressive. They could find it by random search, but they won't go in because the whole surroundings are too unfamiliar. So this led to the idea of doing it on a ship at sea. And fortunately, in 1995, I managed to persuade the Royal Dutch Navy to do this experiment on their main research vessel, which took off from Den Helder in the Netherlands and went to St. Martin in the Caribbean and back again, a distance of at least 8,000 kilometers. Now, those experiments were all filmed. The filmmaker who made the film was waiting to turn them into a proper feature film about this amazing experiment where pigeons were finding a moving ship over distances of over 100 kilometers. It was an astonishing, unprecedented experiment. But then he died, and the footage was temporarily lost. And a few weeks ago, his widow, who was clearing out the house, found the footage from these spectacular pigeon experiments. And they sent it over to me in England last week. And I've just had it digitized. And actually, the results of this amazing Dutch experiment are on this hard drive. There's 500 gigabytes here from something like 40 hours of filming. And I've started looking at it. The quality is really good, but obviously take at least 40 hours to see it. I haven't had time to look at it all yet. But this is very much an ongoing project. I don't think I'll be able to persuade the Royal Dutch Navy to do it again because the Admiral who was my contact and who was a keen pigeon fancier, has retired. So I'm looking for billionaires with underemployed super yachts. So if anyone's got an oligarch super yacht and feels they need to put it to good use, here's an opportunity for an experiment using homing pigeons. So I think this experiment would be perfectly feasible. And there are an awful lot of these super yachts that are underemployed. So I'm hoping it'll be possible to get this experiment going again. Now, I want now to come on to the ways to go beyond and why they work. And the key feature of ways to go beyond, as the name implies, it's about our minds going beyond our normal states of consciousness, going beyond the limits that science would also tell us that we have. Normal, regular materialist science says that our minds are nothing but the activity of our brains, that we live in an unconscious universe. There's no God out there. There's no spirits. There's no mysterious powers or properties out there. It's just inanimate mechanism that's unconscious. And minds are only confined to the insides of human heads and maybe the heads of higher animals, or possibly even lower animals as well, but at least animals. And that the entire universe, the stars, the galaxies, everything else is unconscious. That's the normal view. Now, anyone who has a mystical experience, and many people have them spontaneously, and also in like in near-death experiences, where people feel their consciousness to be part of a vastly greater consciousness than their own. Now, surprisingly, many people have had spontaneous mystical experiences. Many people have them when they're children. They happen to people in moments of stress. They happen in moments of enjoyment when they're in nature. They happen through music. They can happen through liturgies and rituals. They can happen through psychedelics. There are many ways in which people feel a sense of connection with something greater than themselves, a conscious presence of a mind greater than their own. And I think that this is the basis of all religions. I think they all start from this insight, this direct experience of a consciousness greater than our own, of which our own consciousness is part. And we become aware of this in these moments of the mystical experience, or unitive experience, as some people call it. And these experiences are often for people some of the most important experiences of their lives. People who've had near-death experiences as a result of an accident or a heart attack often find themselves going out of their bodies, going through a tunnel into a realm of light and joy and bliss, where they feel tremendously happy, wonderfully connected. And many of them rather regret the fact they have to go back. And of course they have to go back because it's only a near-death experience. But this experience of may only last 2 or 3 minutes. And yet for some people, it completely changes their life. They no longer fear death. They are aware there's some greater spiritual reality. This is not like trying to prove to someone God exists by saying God exists because it says so in the Bible or some other holy text, or by saying we've got some mathematical proof there must be a God based on Gödel's incompleteness of mathematics theorem or something. That's not why most people believe in God. It's not why most people who started religions started religions. The reason people believe in God, or at least in a consciousness greater than their own, is not because they've been told to believe in it, it's because they've experienced it. I mean, I believe there's a consciousness greater than our own because I've experienced it. You could say in a way that I know it rather than believe it. And most people who've had these experiences know that there's something greater than ourselves. And religions provide ways of putting this within rituals and stories and within communities and having this other dimension as part of our whole way of life and passing it on to other generations. But the core, at the root of them all, are these experiences. And spiritual practices are ways we can cultivate these experiences. We can make it more likely that we have these experiences than if we just leave it to chance. They may happen anyway. But all religions have a series of spiritual practices which can help in bringing us closer to this other dimension. And the reason that people like being closer to this other dimension is that it's usually blissful or joyful to be in contact with this consciousness greater than ourselves. And also, there have now been many scientific studies of the effects of religious and spiritual practices. And what they show is that people who have these practices are, on average, happier, healthier, and live longer than those that don't. So these practices are very beneficial for your health. They also help your popularity. People who have these practices are usually more cheerful, less depressed, more grateful, and they tend to be more popular than people who are discontented, miserable, and complain all the time. I wrote a book called Science and Spiritual Practices about seven different spiritual practices that have been investigated scientifically. And this book, Ways to Go Beyond, is about a further seven practices which can help us in this greater sense of connection. The practice, I don't have time to go into them all, but the first one I discuss is about sport. And many people would find this very surprising because sport is seen as a completely secular pursuit rather than a spiritual pursuit, except in the East, where it's always been seen as having a spiritual dimension, as in a famous book called Zen and the Art of Archery, published in the 50s, 1950s. And also in the martial arts, it's often taught, along with Oriental martial arts, that this is about not just about energy flow, not just about trying to win fights. It's not primarily about that. It's a kind of spiritual discipline about leading your life and moving your body in a more harmonious kind of way. And Tai Chi is where it morphs into almost pure spiritual practice from a martial art. However, in the West, sports are usually treated as competitive. It's there for winning and so forth. But actually, that's not the case. Many sports are not games or competitive. Mountain climbing, for example, or tightrope walking, or skateboarding. And these are not team games or sports or things where you just win. I mean, you can win competitions through technique, etc., but it's not primarily about winning. And even team games like football are not primarily about winning. People love playing football, even if they lose. What they're about, I think, is about being in the present. And all spiritual practices are related to being in the present in some way. You can only be present to a greater consciousness or greater reality if you're actually in the present. And sports bring people into the present in a most remarkable way. And the more dangerous the sport, the more they bring them into the present, which is why some people love really dangerous sports like motorcycle racing or free solo climbing, where they're climbing incredibly dangerous mountains without ropes. And if they one foot wrong and they're dead. And people who do that say that the reason they do it is because it's ecstatic, the feeling they're so completely present in that moment, that it is for them a spiritual experience. And many people who practice sports do have spiritual experiences through doing so, this sense of being intensely present. The second practice I discuss is about learning from animals. And I'm going to come back to that one in a minute, take up from homing pigeons, which I've just been talking about. Then I talk about fasting. All religions have fasting as one of their practices. Jewish people fast on Yom Kippur, Muslims during daylight hours of Ramadan. Many Christians fast during Lent, either a partial fast, giving up alcohol or chocolate or something for Lent, or full-scale fast with no food, or at least for part of Lent, the period that leads up to Easter. I myself fast during Holy Week, just been doing it, the period leading up to Easter, 4 days. I did it for this year, only tea and water, no solid food, no other food, no food. And so fasting is a widespread practice. And fasting is psychoactive. It leads to the production of what are called ketone bodies, which circulate in the blood, acetone, acetoacetic acid, and beta-hydroxybutyric acid. So these substances in the blood affect neurotransmitter levels in the brain, and fasting can have a psychoactive effect. I think you'd probably have to fast for quite a long time before you got really extreme sort of hallucinations or visions. But fasting is also very helpful as a discipline. It helps with prayer and meditation. I also have a chapter in this book on psychedelics, because for many people in the modern world, psychedelics are a kind of gateway experience to spiritual experiences. Many people find through psychedelics, which are almost like a kind of rite of passage for a lot of people brought up in the very materialistic world we have, in the very materialistic educational system, the psychedelics literally open the mind. Psychedelic means psyche revealing, psychedelic, mind opening or mind revealing. And many people feel their minds are greatly opened, and they feel that there are dimensions of the mind beyond their own, which takes many people into the realm of spiritual experience. And of course, in some shamanic cultures, they are used as a religious or spiritual practice, as they are in the psychedelic church of Santo Daime, a Brazilian psychedelic church, which is very popular in Brazil, and it's spreading in Europe as well. So psychedelics can be a spiritual practice. For some people it's not, for some people it's just tripping, and for some people taken ill-advisedly, it can also lead to psychosis and can be dangerous. So I'm certainly not advocating that everyone takes psychedelics in an unsupervised way, but I think done in the right circumstances, for some people it can be this practice can be very helpful. And then prayer. All religions encourage prayer, and here I'm talking about petitionary prayer, praying for things. Some would think of this as the lowest kind of prayer, but it's the most practical, and it's the one that's most widely practiced in the world. Even people who don't go to church, or even some who think of themselves as atheists, still pray. And prayer is a way of connecting ourselves with something greater than ourselves. You have to believe in something greater than yourself to pray. At least implicitly, you have to believe that, because there's no point praying to nothing. If you say, I'm just praying to a pointless mechanical universe that has no consciousness and can't hear my prayers, there wouldn't be much point. But if you feel there's gods or spirits or ancestors or saints or angels who can be aware of your prayers and in some way respond to them, then you can pray. And many people do pray, and there are now scientific studies that show that for those who pray, it's often very beneficial for their physical and mental and spiritual health. I myself pray every day. I meditate in the mornings, I pray in the evenings. And prayer, again, differs from meditation. Meditation's, I think, more like breathing in. You It's like withdrawing from the world. You stop looking around you, stop thinking about things as much as you can by concentrating on your breath or on a mantra, or the sensations in your body. It's about detaching yourself from normal everyday concerns, the things you might worry or ruminate about. Well, prayer is the opposite. You start by invoking a spiritual being, like Our Father who art in heaven, or Hail Mary, full of grace, or Om Namah Shivaya, or whoever the God or saint you're praying to. You start by invoking them. And then, having made that spiritual connection through the invocation, you then bring to mind, you can give thanks for all things you're thankful for, connecting the spiritual connection with the things in your life for which you're grateful, which have been a blessing on your life. And then you can ask for things that are worrying you or preoccupying you, people who are ill, that you want to pray for them to get better, or things you're afraid of that you want protection from or releasing from the fear. You can then pray about these things. And so it's bringing the spiritual realm, bringing it out into the world through your intentions, through these prayers, connecting the spiritual with the outer world, moving outwards, whereas meditation is more like moving inwards, withdrawing your attention and your thoughts from the outer world and becoming present in that spiritual presence, which can happen during periods of meditation. Most people who meditate find their mind is wandering a lot of the time. I do. I've meditated for years. But there are times when there's a much greater sense of peace and calmness and presence. So there's a chapter on prayer. And it's a chapter on festivals and celebrations and holy days. And this is important because some spiritual practices are quite individual. Like meditation, you can sit alone in a room in the quiet, or you can pray alone in a room in the quiet. You can also pray with other people, like in church, but many people pray by themselves. I do every evening before I go to bed. But festivals and holy days are when we celebrate together, and we're social beings, we're social animals. And one of the things that makes religion different from individual spiritual practice is that it has a collective dimension. It brings in other people. And festivals are ways we celebrate with others. And festivals are usually feasts and times of celebration. And when we feast, it's hard to feast alone. But if you're feasting with others, like here in England, Christmas dinner is probably our major national time of feasting, when we go at least with our families. But Easter is also an important festival. And the midsummer festivals all over Europe in the Middle Ages were enormously important around the summer solstice, particularly St. John's Day, which is June the 24th, soon after the summer solstice, just as Christmas is soon after the winter solstice. And those great times of celebration in these summer festivals have come back again in the form of music festivals, like the Glastonbury Festival here in England. Our biggest music festival actually happens over St. John's Day, and that's when it's timed for. And it is, in a way, a recreation of this ancient midsummer time of festival, of singing, of dancing, of being together and celebrating together. And holy days, which in the Jewish tradition are on the Sabbath, the Saturday, the Christian tradition Sunday, the Muslim tradition Friday, these weekly holy days are holidays. The English word holiday is the same word as holy day. And a holy day is a holiday. And if it's a holiday for everyone, then everyone can celebrate together. And that's why I think it's very important to preserve this sense of holy days, like for those from Christian backgrounds, Sundays, for those in Jewish backgrounds, Saturdays, from Muslim backgrounds, Fridays, to have a day that really is special and different. Otherwise, we're overwhelmed with 24/7 Americanized workaholic culture. And Sundays become just like every other day, full of business, shops open, online business, Amazon deliveries, etc., eroding the difference. And then they would say, well, we give our workers who work on Sundays, we give them Tuesday off instead. But if you've got Tuesday off instead and everyone else is working on Tuesday, you're thrown into an isolated position. You miss the whole point of being on holiday with others and celebrating with others. And in the European calendar, there are a number of important festivals, typically at the solstices and equinoxes, or close to them. Easter's very close to the spring equinox. The Feast of St. Michael and All Angels, the heavenly beings, those non-human intelligences, is on September the 29th, soon after the autumn equinox. St. John's Day is after the summer solstice, Christmas after the winter solstice. And then in between, we have four more festivals. Candlemas in beginning of February, a festival of light, May Day, which is still a major festival day in Europe, beginning of May. Then August the 1st or 2nd, Lammas, which is an early harvest festival. And then one of the biggest, November the 1st, 2nd, is the Day of the Dead, the All Saints Day and All Souls Day, and the eve of that festival, Halloween, All Hallows Eve, is celebrated by children in America and in parts of Europe. But it's only really in Catholic countries that the Day of the Dead is celebrated on a grand scale, as in Mexico, where the Day of the Dead, November the 2nd, is a huge national festival. And interestingly, a Disney film, Coco, has popularized the Day of the Dead. So it's now well known as part of popular culture. And I think it's important to reinvigorate these festivals because the Day of the Dead, we all have ancestors, we all know people who have died. It's very important to acknowledge them, and this is the official day for doing it. And here in Britain, Anglican and Roman Catholic churches all have Requiem Masses for on or around All Souls Day. And you can, at home, you can light a candle and remember your ancestors. And you can do this in various ways. But I think these days are very important because they punctuate the year. They give a structure to the year, these festivals and the holy days. And they give us times to celebrate and to focus on different aspects of our lives and deaths, in the case of All Souls Day, which structure our year. And so that again is a spiritual practice. And of course, celebrating with other people can be one of the most joyous occasions that there is. And being happy and dancing together is quite wonderful. It's probably one of the highest forms of human collective enjoyment, feasting and dancing, which is why at weddings, people have wedding feasts, dancing and feasting, and why on our great festivals, there's like the summer festival, there's feasting and dancing. Although in the Glastonbury festival, there's not much feasting, there's mainly dancing. But anyway, that's a spiritual practice too. And finally, I have a chapter on cultivating good habits, like the different virtues, like courage and temperance and justice and love and faith and hope, avoiding the vices like the seven deadly sins: pride, envy, anger, greed, avarice, sloth, laziness. It's in the ancient world, it was thought a very important part of education was to encourage good habits, virtues, and avoid bad habits, vices. And in a modern secular world, you can't really do that very much because people are, who's to decide what's good and what's bad? You know, why should we accept these arbitrary things from the past? And, you know, and so on. And virtues sound hopelessly old-fashioned. And yet, unless we cultivate these, of which love and kindness are one of the most important, all these other spiritual practices could become self-indulgences. We could, for example, really enjoy the revelations that come through psychedelics, have a fantastic time with the psychedelics, but it wouldn't do anyone else any good. If, however, it connects us, and if these other practices connect us with that greater spiritual reality, and we then realize that that connection implies a greater kinship with other people. Being kind in English, that comes from the same root as kin, as in kindred, you know, people you're related to. And being kind is a supreme virtues, is part of love, which is the principle of the three Christian virtues in the traditional medieval categorization. That the spiritual practice of cultivating virtues and avoiding vices is really something that is important as a background for all the others. And all religions, of course, encourage people to cultivate virtues and avoid vices. But if you're spiritual but not religious, of course you can have these spiritual practices, but then it's important to bring back that aspect. It doesn't have to be within the framework of an organized religion, but it's very important to have that aspect of relationship to others and how we behave in the world, not just being kind to others, but being kind to the world we live in, not trashing it, not emitting more carbon than we need, and so on. So those are some of the principal themes. And I just have a few more minutes to talk a little bit more about animals and learning from animals. I was talking in my seven experiment, when I talked about the Seven Experiments book, about unexplained powers of animals. We can learn a great deal from animals about the way they coordinate their activities, like termites, about their sensitivity to other people's feelings and intentions, even at a distance, as in dogs that know when their owners are coming home, and in the remarkable sense of direction that pigeons and many other animals have. Even dogs and cats, if they're lost hundreds of kilometers from their home, can often find their way back, even though they've had no practice at this. There are often stories in newspapers about dogs and cats that have found their way home over enormous distances. Well, that's one thing we can learn from animals. We can learn about aspects of their minds, extended minds that link them to others, members of their group, that link them to the environment, that give them a sense of direction, and also that link them to the future, because many animals can pick up what's going to happen. Dogs and cats and many other animals give warnings of earthquakes or tsunamis, sometimes several days in advance. They can pick up things that are going to happen in a way that most humans can't. Even seismologists with sophisticated equipment can't predict earthquakes in any detail, and yet animals can do it better than humans can. And if we paid more attention to animals, we could probably develop very good earthquake warning systems. Google Maps, for example, if people had an app where they just put in when they see unusual animal behavior, if certain parts of the world start sort of glowing red with many reports of this kind, it could indicate an upcoming earthquake. And with sophisticated analysis of results and research, it might be possible to have animal-based early warning systems, which don't exist at present. That's another thing we can learn from animals. We can also learn from about sensory capacities. Dogs can smell much more than we can. Bats can echolocate in a way that humans simply can't. Gibbons can leap from branch to branch of trees in a graceful way that we couldn't possibly do. Birds can fly, which we can't. Fish can swim at great depths in the sea without coming up to breathe for long periods of time, which we can't. Animals can do lots of things we can't. And that, I think, is important for giving us a sense of humility. We like to think of ourselves as in charge of this world, vastly superior to all the animals, well, we're better at making computers, we're better at speaking human languages, we're better at inventing, designing cities and making buildings and in quite a number of ways. But in lots of other ways, non-human animals are superior to us. And then the final point I want to make about animals is that their minds are not racing all the time. They don't have language in the same way we do. They don't have our inner dialogues in the way we do. We have a constant chatter going in our minds associated with what's called the default mode network, a series of brain regions that are connected together, which are active when we're worrying or thinking or ruminating or when we're anxious or when we're daydreaming or when we've just got a chatter going on, there's ceaseless thoughts going on in our minds. Animals don't have that, at least as far as we know, they don't have that. And spiritual practices like meditation are about coming into the present. Well, I think an awful lot of animals don't need to do meditation to come into the present. I think they're in the present already. I think a lizard basking in the sun on a sunny rock may be in a state of bliss. It may be like in a state of meditative bliss, completely present and very happy to be where it is, right there, right then. When a cat sits on your lap and you're stroking it and it's purring, it's very happy just to be purring, and its purring noise tells us that it's there in the present. It's sort of not worrying about, will I get fed tomorrow, or will I be able to catch a mouse tomorrow morning, or is there another cat going to invade my garden this afternoon? It's just content to be there, to be present. When a dog has a stick in its mouth or a ball and it's there crouching down, wanting you to throw the stick for it, it wants to play. You know it wants to play. And it can bring you into the present with it as you throw the stick, and it comes back eagerly wanting more. I think probably the main reason that so many people in modern industrial societies keep animals is because those animals bring them into the present and actually do something that a spiritual practice would do in bringing you much more into the present and away from these endlessly discursive thoughts that go through our minds left to their own devices. If you think about it, I mean, in Estonia, in Britain, in most parts of the developed world, keeping pets is expensive. You have big bills with the vet. Taking a dog for a walk is something you have to do every day. And then every time there's a sort of shit on the pavement, you have to pick it up in a plastic bag. I mean, that's not much fun. And when you go away, you've got to find someone to look after the dog. All these things are not much fun. If you've got a cat, you've got to empty his litter tray. Why do people go to all this trouble, time and expense? They don't need dogs and cats to kill farmyard animals or to guard their house in a modern city, as people did in rural villages in the past. I think people have them because they give us that greater sense of life, that greater sense of being in the present, which otherwise we would lack in the modern world, which takes us away from that spiritual dimension, that experience of being in the presence of consciousness greater than our own, which is what Ways to Go Beyond is all about. So I hope in this last hour, I've managed to give you some sense of the way in which it's possible to go beyond the limitations of science through experiments that press on the weak points of the scientific worldview, a bit like acupuncture points. And these seven experiments, I think, could all help to lead us on beyond where we are in science and beyond the idea that our minds are confined to the insides of our heads. And Ways to Go Beyond is about these spiritual practices which enable us to realize that our minds, our consciousness, is part of a vastly greater consciousness than our own, that links us to other people and links us to the rest of nature. And when we re-establish that connection, when we feel that connection, when we can live with that sense of connection, our lives will be happier, more connected. We'll be less prone to depression, less prone to addiction, and more helpful to other people, better able to get on with others, lead healthier, happier, and more satisfying lives. If we don't have those practices, we'll lead lives that are more separate, more prone to depression, more shut up within ourselves. In fact, the characteristics of the modern industrial secular society. But our ancestors had ways of going beyond that. They still exist in the modern world. In fact, they're undergoing a revival at the moment. And so I hope that this book, if you read it, will help you in that. And I hope that just thinking about how you can open yourself to these more than human realms in your own life will be of great help to you, making your life happier, more satisfying, and more helpful to others and to the earth.